Today we will start with the next type of data structure called as the linked list. And before we actually proceed to the linked list, we will have to discuss something like the memory allocation type. We will have to see what are the different ways in which the memory can be allocated. Now, why do we require memory? For storage of data. We require memory for the storage of data. Right. Now, in when that particular memory will be allocated? When we declare the variables. Declaration of variables. I suppose there are two ways in which the variables can be declared. Global and local, yes. So variables can be declared either globally or locally. What is the difference? Where do you declare the global variables? Above main, starting, give me the precise answer. And where are the local variables? In the function or inside main? Inside a function. Then where are the global variables declared? Outside the function. Yes, yes. It's not above main or something like that. It is not within the scope of any function. What is the scope of function? When we say that it is the scope of the function, means what? There will be two words. There will be two words. One is scope and other is called as life. Of course, we are talking it with respect to the variables. But before that, what is the scope of a function?
The variables it can access.
No. Actually, scope, when we say, it is the group of the statements which are in that function. That is, from opening curly bracket to closing curly bracket will be the scope of it. So the scope of the variables, when we say, which are declared locally, the scope will be restricted to that function. Scope is restricted to that function. With the variable which is declared inside the function, which is called as local variable, its scope will be restricted to that function. We'll say it is restricted to that function. That means the variable which is declared inside the function will be accessible through that function only. So the scope is restricted to that function. And what about the scope of the global variables? Scope of the global variables. I have just defined what is a scope. The variable can be accessed from. It is restricted to that function. Global? Yeah, all functions. All the functions can access that. What about the life? How do we define the life of the variable? What is the life of the variable? Where the variable is visible, that is going to be the scope. Life will be that span, that time span, when the memory is allocated to that variable and when the memory for that variable is set free. Are you getting me? Memory will be allocated to that variable and memory will be set free. That will be the life. So scope in turn we will say accessibility. Whereas life can be thought of the time taken for from the allocation to free. Time taken for the allocation of the memory to that particular memory set free. That will be the life of the variable. Whereas scope is the accessibility from where it will be accessible. So scope of the local variable is restricted to that function in which it is declared. Whereas life of that particular variable will be from call to that function till termination. The life of that variable, memory will be allocated at the time the function is called. It's not that all the variables they will be allocated the memory. The function which is called, before we actually go to that particular function, memory for the variables inside that function will be allocated. Then within the scope of that particular function, that memory will be referred. And when you return back from that function, all the variables which are allocated the memory, they will be set free. So ultimately from the call to that function till its termination will be the life of the local variables. What will be the life of the global variables? We don't have anything like a program. See, main is also a function. No? Main also has got the local variable. Which block? First of all, we are not talking about initialization. We are just restricting. But it is declared globally. Global declaration is the declaration outside the function. Right. From the beginning of the execution, from the start of execution till the termination of execution of that program. As a whole, not main. Okay? We'll say life is throughout the execution. That will be the life of the global variables. Okay? Now, when will this memory be allocated? For local variables, we have said that the life is from call till termination. That means when the function is called, memory is allocated. For global, normally you will find that it is a compile time allocation. Allocation will be at the time of compilation. What will you say about the local variables? It's not the allocation at the compilation time, because all those which are global, they require throughout the memory throughout the program execution. So memory will be allocated at the compilation time. When program terminates, it will be set key. What about local variables? Memory will be allocated when the function is called. So we will in a way say that it is a runtime type of allocation. During the execution time, memory will be allocated. But of course remember that we are not going to perform that job of allocation and freeing. It will be in a way done automatically. And you know that in C we even have the keyword auto. That stands for the automatic allocation. So all the variables default are automatic type. Okay? So allocation could be compilation time, run time. To be precise, it is automatic. When the function is called, it will be allocated. When the function is terminated, it will be set free. Okay? Along with this, there is something else, some other type of allocation also, called as static allocation. The allocation type is static. Have you used this word static up till now? Have you used it? Where? Where have you used this word static? And what was the necessity? See that I want to count number of times the function is entered. I am not saying number of times function is called, I am saying number of times function is entered. I want a counter for it. Meaning that I am not allowing you to put a check before. That is, whenever you are calling the function, before that you write count plus plus. That should not be the policy. Meaning that, suppose it is function fun1, suppose. Then I can declare int cnt. And then I increment the count. Baki kaam to chalta rahe. So this cnt is specially written to check how many times, because it is the very first statement. You enter the function, counter is increment. But when you write it in this manner, what happens is every time memory will be allocated to counter, because it is default automatic, it is local. And every time it will be set to 0, and every time it will be incremented to 1 only. Getting it? Now he was giving me the example of recursion. Actually there could be another call to function 1 from the function 1 itself, which is called as a recursion, function calling itself. Or there could be some indirect recursion also, function 1 calling function 2 and function 2 again calling function 1. And so function 1 could be entered multiple times. Through main I can see only one call, but internally there could be multiple calls. And every time I want to increment the counter. But every time memory will be allocated for counter, and every time counter will be set to 1. Instead of that, if we declare this int counter as a static type, that means we are deferring the allocation policy to static. then what is going to happen, though it is a local variable, it will be shifted to a static nature, that is different from automatic. Static will be the one, it will be allocated the memory only when the function is called for the first time, and all the successive calls of this function will not allocate memory for counter, neither it will be initialized. When the function is called for the first time, the memory for the static variable will be allocated, okay, and then for the next call this function will be skipped, this particular statement will be skipped, there will be no action against it. So it is deferred from automatic to static. But all the functions, one, all those which are called one after the other, they will still access the same memory location for counter. They are using count, cnt. Second call of it will use cnt, third call of it will use cnt. Earlier each call was having its own allocation for cnt. Now all the calls, they will refer to the same memory location for cnt, which is allocated when the function is called for the first time. But it is not global. Scope of this, that is the position from where it is accessed, is still restricted to that function. So it is not global. The same job you could have done by declaring counter as global, so that you enter the function and increment. But we are not doing it that way. We are restricting the scope to that function. Allocation will be with the first function call, and access will be to all the functions, all the function calls of fun1. So they will access the same memory location. Such a thing is called as static. So we have seen compile time allocation, which is for the global variables, runtime or automatic to be precise, the allocation for the local variables, and a static, which is again which can be taken care of at the compilation time. But normally at the first call memory is allocated, it is initialized, and the life will be from that point till the termination of the program, but the scope is still restricted to that function. That is static. And there is one more which is of our interest, called as dynamic allocation. Now in all these cases, whether it is global, local or static, the responsibility is still taken by the compiler to preserve the information as whether the memory is to be allocated, how much memory is to be allocated, when it is to be allocated, when it is to be set free. Responsibility is still taken by the compiler. Life and scope will be decided internally for each time. But when we talk about dynamic allocation, dynamic allocation will be the one where the programmer decides. Programmer can allocate or free memory. Of course, it is going to be runtime. Allocation will be done at the runtime. So here we should be using the word runtime allocation for dynamic allocation. For automatic, though it is runtime, kyunki allocation hoga to runtime, pehle to nahi hota. But programmer cannot control it. Programmer will have to simply give the declaration and the system will take care of it. Global will be done at the compilation time. Life is throughout the execution of the program. Scope is to all functions. Here scope will be restricted to that function, life is again restricted till the termination of that function. To differentiate from automatic, we also have static, where life, once it is allocated, will be till the termination of the program, but scope is restricted to that function. Whereas when we go for dynamic allocation, memory allocation decision will be solely of the programmer. Programmer can allocate the memory, programmer can free the memory, and of course it is going to be the execution time. Okay, so remember these types of allocations: global, local, to be precise, compile time, automatic, static, and dynamic. Okay, make a note. Write it properly. First this part, then for static, write this example clearly and say that all the calls of FUN1, they will refer to the same memory location. Every call will not allocate memory for counter. See it. Okay. Now, why the programmer should take the responsibility of allocating the memory when the compiler has provided us with so many facilities, so many different allocation types like the global, automatic, static? If all of them are there, what is the need of having the dynamic allocation, that is during the execution time? Remember the simple case that if I am required to store some name in the memory, then obviously we will be going for the string, that is nothing but array. And now when we use array, what should be the size of this particular string? How will you decide what should be the length? At the most, you can have the look at all the data items and see what is the longest name before you write the program. But that could be dependent on that set. Afterwards, you might find somebody whose name is much more than that. So if you generally allocate, say, memory of 40 characters for name, then most of the times you are using lesser memory. Not exactly all the 40 bytes. And at rare occasions you will be going outside. But effectively, if there are 100 names and on an average 10 bytes are wasted, in that case there will be lot of wastage of memory. And there could be wastage or there could be shortfall. Some name having 70 characters, obviously you cannot store it. Remaining 30 characters you will have to simply cut down, because you don't have the storage for it. Got it? So for the optimum use of the memory, we should hand over the responsibility to the programmer. Because generally what even you might be thinking of when you have learned array is something like this, that I will accept n from the user and then declare array A of size n. Because even in the arrays program we used to do it this way only, saying that there are 100 elements and then ask the user as how many elements you want to use. Not other way around. First you ask the user as how many elements are there, and then you go for the declaration. This is not allowed, because this cannot be variable, this has to be a constant. This has to be a constant. So this is definitely not permitted, but this is what the expectation will be. That is, I decide, I find with the user as how many values are to be stored, and accordingly I go for the allocation. And so we hand over the responsibility for the optimum use. Use of memory. To use the memory in the optimum manner, to avoid the wastage, we will ask the programmer to allocate the memory. And for memory allocation, we have got the function like malloc, say size of int, and I will have to typecast it as the pointer to integer, and then I can store it in some variable which is by itself a pointer. This malloc or malloc is nothing but the function for memory allocation. This is available from alloc.h, and we should be informing this particular memory allocation function as the memory of what size should be allocated. Int ke liye aapko pata hai ki it is 2, character ke liye 1, float ke liye 4. But otherwise, when it is a combination, that is a structure, then we can ask the responsibility, hand over this responsibility to some other function to calculate the size in bytes. So another function, size of, which is again declared in alloc.h, can be used, and to this alloc.h we should pass the type, any data type. Size of function will calculate that. So in this case, size of int will come out to be 2, and memory allocation of 2 bytes will be performed, and whatever is the memory that is allocated of 2 bytes, its start address, which is of course typecasted to integer pointer, it is integer pointer, that particular address will be returned by malloc and now will be stored in PTR. So in a way, what is the allocation type for PTR? यही तो फर्क है. अलोकेशन फॉर पीटीआर, पीटीआर विल हैव ऑटोमेटिक अलोकेशन. पीटीआर इज सिंपली अ लोकल वेरिएबल, अ वेरिएबल विच कैन स्टोर द एड्रेस. यूजर इज अलोकेटिंग द मेमोरी फॉर इंटीजर. User is allocating memory for integer. So for this integer, the memory allocation is dynamic and its address is stored here. PTR jahan pe hoga, PTR is again a variable. What are the contents of that variable? Address. So PTR is an a variable jisko ke memory allocate karni padegi. Kaise hogi wo? That is going to be automatic. So there will be some location associated with PTR of generally 4 bytes, and the contents of PTR, which is going to be address, that can be the address which is returned by malloc. So ultimately, which is dynamic allocation over here? PTR is not dynamically allocated. Memory for storing integer is dynamically allocated, and its address comes to PTR because we are writing PTR equal. Got it? Another function which can be used is, say, char star s, and I can say s is equal to char star calloc n comma size of char, and I can very well accept n from the user. as what is the length of the string that you are giving. Calloc. Malloc can allocate the memory for only one variable, one storage of data, not multiple. If you want to store 10 integers, you cannot use malloc. Because here you cannot say int, size of int into 10. Ye kehna galat hoga. You cannot say it that way. Okay? This will be always used for allocating memory for one data item. Whereas calloc will allocate the consecutive memory location such that each data is of character type and such n data items. Something that I was trying to do here. Of course, over there it was integer type. I was accepting the size and then trying to allocate the area for that particular array. Something similar to that can be done using calloc. So basically two functions for dynamic allocation one has to study. Most of the times we will be using malloc, at least in this course initially, and even calloc also. Dynamic, again in this case, S will have allocation type as automatic. And then what is dynamically allocated memory? It will be n bytes. Again, this memory has no name. There is no name associated with this memory. This memory is not associated with any name. Otherwise, memory location for all the variables which are declared, they are associated with the name. A means which location, B means which location, where is PTR, where is name. So every name is associated, every identifier is associated with memory location, or every memory location is associated with name up till now. But henceforth, there will be some memory locations which are used by our program, but they are not given any name. Only their address matters, and that address could be with some pointer. So pointer again will be PTR, is the name associated with this memory location. You can have S again of 4 bytes, and it will contain the address, start address of this bunch of memory. Okay? Dynamic allocation. Make a note. The need of dynamic allocation is obviously for the optimum usage of the memory. Memory should be handled in the optimum manner. Memory will be allocated by using the functions, and for most of the memory handling functions are present in alloc.h. So you will have to include alloc.h right at the beginning. Writing some type before the function, it is not the return type, this is called as type casting. Whatever is the address returned by malloc is considered as address of integer and then stored. Such a statement is called as type casting. It is conversion of one type into another, type cast. You can try on your compiler. Generally, when alloc.h is included, this typecasting can be eliminated. But if at all your malloc is giving some warning when you are compiling the program and you don't know how to eliminate it, then it is going to be the typecasting that will be the basic necessity. Some compilers allow without typecasting, some compilers will force you to typecast. Of course, whatever is size of, uska star pehle likhna. Size of int, it will be typecasted as int star. Size of char, it will be typecasted as char star. Yeah. For the structure also, it is going to be a type, and you may need typecasting dependent on the compiler. Because if for structure you need typecasting, you will need typecasting for integers also. For all the types you will require typecasting. And if your compiler supports without that, then even if you go for malloc size of struct something, there will not be any error, no warning. It will be typecasted internally. Now normally when the data is processed or the data is collected, at that time we are not exactly sure as how many data items are going to be used in that particular program or during that execution. How many data items the user is going to give, that is not known. Okay? And so you will have to simply keep on accepting the data, process it, store it. You might again ask the user whether there is another data item which is present. If user says yes, take it. Earlier when we used to write such a program, it was bound by the array limit. Suppose I am writing the result manipulation type of program, result calculation, and if I have declared array of 100, then after processing or storing the names of 100 students, if there is any more student which is present, you cannot proceed. You will have to simply say that the array is full, we cannot go ahead. Okay? Or even in our last queue application, if more and more data items come up, in that case you will reach the condition as queue full, whereas you should be in a position to allocate the memory for the next ones. Now as we have seen the previous statement, that is to allocate the memory and store its address in a pointer. Now what happens is, for the next memory allocation for the data, I will have to again pick up its address and store it in some pointer. Because if I store it again in PTR, then the previous address will be lost. See, previously the picture was, there is a pointer. I had allocated memory for some integer. It is pointing to this. So as long as I don't overwrite this, I can access that memory. But then, if I say that there is one more data int and the memory is allocated dynamically, now where should I store its address? If I try and store it here, then this will be lost. First of all, you cannot reach that location because its address is lost. Secondly, that memory will be lost forever because there is no other way that you can hit that memory. Ultimately you will say, fir then don't do it like this. Let this be PTR1. Let there be one more PTR2 which will point to this. And if I say there is one more integer, you will say one more PTR3. But then how many such pointers you will have? Because then you say I will use array of pointers. But suppose you use array of pointers and there are 100 pointers, ultimately 100 data items. Means again a restriction. And so this has resulted in the concept of the linked list. What is done is, you allocate the memory for the first value, say value is 300, memory is allocated and its address is stored somewhere. So I remember its address. Okay? Now I want to store, I ask whether any more data item, answer is yes, value is say 279. Now the job is, where should I store its address? So we say that when I am allocating the memory for this 300, I will allocate some extra memory for one pointer also. I will allocate the memory for one pointer. So at first position I will store the address and the next position I will utilize for storing the address of this memory. So I have no problem, because whenever I allocate the memory for one data, automatically memory for one pointer is allocated, so I don't have to bother about how many pointers I should have. Every time you allocate memory for data, memory for the pointer also will be allocated. And that pointer will be set free what I in all I will have to remember is the location for the first one, start, so that I can come here, I process this data and I check whether there is address of some next location. If that address is present, fine, I will go there, process that data. Now I find that there is no address. If there would have been some other address over here, I would have gone to that location. So there happens to be a link. There happens to be a link between the data items, which is set through the address or the pointer. And then this will form a linked list. Now there is no restriction, because I will have to declare only one pointer. Every time I allocate the memory and I store its address with the previous node. Okay. Now to do this job, we will have struct say singly, in which I will have say int data, and I require a pointer. What will be the type of this pointer? It is again pointing to the structure of the same type. What will this structure contain? One data and one pointer. One data means this data could be of any length. It could be name, roll number, marks, whatever. Collectively it is data. And one pointer, which is going to point to the next node, next position. And that pointer will be obviously of struct singly type, which I will name it as the address of the next one. Name of the variable is next. This you can expand, but there will be one pointer. Got it? But then I will go for what we have seen earlier as declaring a new type, type dev, and I will declare it as type SLL. So instead of every time writing struct singly, I will use the new type SLL. Now the main job that we are doing over here is related to allocation. So for allocation, I will have to every time write a function like malloc size of struct singly. To be typecasted as SLL star pointer to struct singly, and its address should be stored in some pointer, say n, and obviously this n should be declared as pointer to SLL. What will this do? It will simply allocate the memory having two fields, data and next. Out of this data we don't know, but whenever we allocate the memory and have some pointer into it, that particular pointer should be set to null, because otherwise that link will continue. Because every time I am going to check whether there is any other node, means I am going to check the address, and if there is some 01 bit pattern present, that can be interpreted as an address. And you might be reaching some memory which is not allocated for. So to put a dead end, we will have to always set the pointer to null. So I will say n. Now n is a pointer. N arrow, I will be accessing the fields. Somebody was asking me how to, where is arrow on the keyboard. So it's not arrow, it is dash greater than. Left arrow, right arrow, nahi hai. These are two characters. Huh? We write it like that. So n arrow next, that means the field next in the memory that we have allocated. So ye jo memory allocate ho chuki hai abhi, jiska ke address abhi n ke saath hai. N is pointing to the start address. So n arrow data and n arrow next are the two fields. Or if there is roll number etc, n arrow roll number, n arrow marks, like that. Out of that, n arrow next should be set to null. And this is actually, these two statements I will have to write again and again in my program. because to form these links I will have to every time allocate the memory. Instead of repeatedly writing them, I can write a function whose name is say getNode. Its purpose is to allocate the memory, set the next pointer to null, and return the return the address, that is n. Obviously, return type of getNode will be SLL star. You are returning n, you are returning the address. Address to struct singly. Struct singly is typed as SLL. So it is going to be SLL star getNode. Two jobs are done. Memory is allocated. Next pointer is set to null. And now, using this, when I go for creating the list, when I try to create the list, see it carefully. See the job. I start with saying header equal to getNode. This is my first statement. What will happen? There will be memory which will be allocated for storing the data and the pointer. We are calling getNode, so next will be automatically set to null. And its address will be with the pointer header. The effect of the first statement. Then I say temp is equal to header. What will happen? What will happen? क्या होगा? ये अब हेडर हैज द एड्रेस ऑफ दिस नोड एंड इवन टेम्प विल हैव द सेम एड्रेस. सो वेदर यू से टेम्प एरो डेटा और हेडर एरो डेटा, यू आर स्टिल पॉइंटिंग टू द सेम लोकेशन, सेम वैल्यू. In step 3, memory is allocated, address will be stored in n, next is null. Fine? Some data is accepted from the user, say 300, and will be stored in the data of n. So this is step 4. Right? Then we said temp arrow next is equal to n. This is something which is interesting. What is n? What does n contain? Address of this node. What is temp arrow next? Temp arrow next is right now null. Temp arrow next is actually the next position in the memory which is allocated or which is pointed by temp. Temp is pointing to the memory location where we have two fields. One is data and other is next. Out of this, the next field should be filled up with the address which is there in n. Ultimately, in step 5, this is what is going to happen. This is step 5. Temp arrow next. Temp जहाँ point कर रहा है उसमें से next field में you store the value which is there in n. Value of n is nothing but the address of the node. So that address will be set. And then I say something like temp is equal to n. Temp is equal to n. What will happen now? What will happen? Temp will point to the new node. Temp will point to the new node. Temp equal to n canis. Or I would have said temp equal to temp arrow next. So temp will now contain the address which is pointed by temp's next. So ye address temp mein aa jayega. Ye address is node ka tha. So ultimately temp will point to the next node. Then I will ask the user, whether user wants to give any more data. If user says yes, then what is to be done? We will have to go back, allocate the memory for new node n. So now this n will point to this. Accept the data, allocate the memory, accept the data. That was 279. Temp arrow next, temp is here. Temp arrow next should point to n. So this address will be stored here. And then temp will come to this location. We can again ask for any more. If yes, allocate the memory, get the data. Temp arrow next. Temp is here remaining every time at the last node. Whereas n is every time picking up the address of the newly allocated node. So temp arrow next will be n, and then temp will be n. Temp will move ahead. So we will have to repeat from here. If user says yes, allocate the memory, take the data, set the link after last node, and then temp will be again the last node. And again ask for any more. Once all this job is done, throughout the process header is still pointing to the first node. So when the entire job is done, temp is at the last node, n is also at the last node, but from last node you cannot come back to the previous node. You will have to remember the address of the first one. That is what we have said right at the beginning, that start up ko yaad rakhna hoga. And so I will be returning header from here, which is unmoved. It is still at the beginning. So if I know header, using header arrow next I can reach the first node. Using its next I can go ahead. So header is of prime importance. That's why I have allocated the memory for header once, and then thereafter I don't have anything like header equal to something. Of course, what you are returning is pointer to struct singly SLL star. This is capable of creating the linked list. Okay? When every time the node is added at the end. Fir bolo, ha? Right down. Header. It has two fields, data and next. it has two fields, data and next. But data field is not used. Next field contains or points to the first node of the list. That is, header is not the part of the list. When header arrow next is null, there is no first node in the list. That is, there is no list. Underline that no list and put a bracket to it. There is empty list. Header arrow next null होने का मतलब है the list exists but it doesn't have any data. It's empty list. Okay? हाँ, अब बोलो. Temp equal to header is not the allocation. First of all, header equal to get node is the allocation of struct singly, and its address will be stored in the pointer header. Whereas when I say temp equal to header, temp will also contain the same address as it is there in header. So header contains address of that node. Temp also will contain the address of the same node. So whether you say header arrow data or temp arrow data, initially they will be pointing to the same location. Header arrow next or temp arrow next, they will still be pointing to the same location. Both are null. Now, up. What does header contain? Header contains the starting point. When you say temp is equal to n, what will happen? Temp will now contain the address of the last node, अभी जो अपने allocate किया था. Okay. Now what is your question?
क्यों?
आप ही ने जवाब दिया भैया. What will header contain initially? Starting address. What will temp contain? Same initially. When temp goes ahead, what will change? The address which is there in temp. What is the address which is stored in header? Starting address. So temp equal to n, I perform once. Temp goes to the first node. Temp equal to n again. Next. Like that. When the loop terminates, where is temp? At the last node. What address is still there in header? Start address. So what is your question? So that's why I'm not starting with temp equal to get node and taking temp ahead. I allocate the memory, I store its address in header, and I have again said that nowhere in my program I will have any other assignment to header. Header equal to ये statement program में एक ही बार आएगा, बार बार नहीं आता. The moment you say header equal to something else, you have lost the address. And header is not the part of the list. College में जब वो पढ़ाएंगे तो शायद header use नहीं करेंगे. But then it is wrong. Because header ना होना, मतलब the difference between there is no list and there is empty list, that has to be understood. हेडर में कुछ नहीं है, हेडर इटसेल्फ इज नल, meaning that there is no list. Header is allocated, so header has the address of the header node, and header arrow next is pointing to the first node of the list. If header arrow next is null, that means there is no first node. First node nahi hoga to second node bhi nahi hoga, matlab list hi nahi hogi. In that case there is empty list. List exists but there is no data. Aur header null hone ka matlab hai that there is no list. So rather than saying head h arrow next is equal to null means there is no list, ye galat hoga. List is there, it is empty. Got it? Any other doubt? Hai to poochho. One more function we will write, that is print list, and I should always pass the start address, that is header. So SLL start temp. Temp is equal to h arrow next. What does it mean? Where will temp point to? Which address will be there in temp after this? Jo address header ke next mein hoga, wo address ab temp mein aa jayega. Header ke next mein kiska address tha? First node ka. So now temp will point to which node? First node. Temp equal to h arrow next means temp is at the first node. बाद में लिखो जरा. What will be printed? Temp is pointing to the first node. So temp arrow data means first node का data print होगा, उसके बाद एक dash greater than print होगा. So I have printed the first node. What should I do now? I should go to the next node. Where is next node? Where is its address? Temp ke next mein hai. So temp should go to temp's next. So temp was pointing to one node. Next node ka address next mein hai. Temp arrow next mein. So I copy that address in temp. So temp which was pointing to this node will now point to the next node. Temp equal to temp arrow next is as good as I plus plus in arrays. Is as good as that. Going to the next. Temp equal to temp arrow next, you go to the next node. If that is not null, you will print the data and you will go to the next. Because there happens to be a node at the end whose next is null. So when temp points to this, its data will be printed. And then I say temp equal to temp arrow next. Temp arrow next is null at that time. So null will be assigned to temp. So temp becomes null. Temp not equal to null was our condition. It is false. So after printing the last data, temp becomes null and we stop. So all the data items have been printed. But now after printing the last data, it has also printed dash greater than. Like the output at this time is like 300, 279, like that. We want to indicate that this is the end of the list. So I will print the word null. So here null will be printed. Haan bol. Haan ye ye. Nine enemy aaya hai. So this will be the output. But then what happened to our concept of header? Because that also should be shown. Jo hum keh rahe hain abhi. So I will have header arrow. So before proceeding to the first node, it will print header arrow. Through loop it will print the data and null. So we are indicating everything that header is pointing to the first node, header arrow next. Then every node will point, and then this is the last node whose next is null. Job is done. Function is void. Got it? So after this, when we proceed, because with these functions I suppose one can test whether the linked list has been created properly, because then you will say void main, you will declare SNL star h, you will say h is equal to create list. Create list will call get node. I am not going to perform anything. Header ko directly ek node allocate karke kuch nahi hone wala. Header is supposed to be the header node of the list. So call create list. Create list will return that address. So h will contain that address, and then you will simply say print list h. So it will just ask. It will ask the data for the first one. You give that data, second, third, keep on saying yes, and when you say no, the list is created. Its header node's address will come back to h. That address you pass on to print list, and then print list will take temp to the first node, will print the list and stop. Every time in any linked list program or dynamic allocation program, first two steps, creation and printing. Once it is printed properly, that means the list is now properly created. Now we can think of any other operation which is to be performed on the list. Without confirming that, one should not proceed. Even if you write other functions, your first main should be having only these many lines. Because all other operations is our standard menu driven part, switch case, which will come below it. Case 1, add karna hai, search karna hai, delete karna hai and what not. वो सब इसके बाद आएगा, राइट? इसलिए सिर्फ इतना पार्ट पहले लिख के रन करो, सो यू विल बी थ्रू विद द डायनामिक एलोकेशन पार्ट, द लिंकिंग पार्ट, एनी अदर प्रॉब्लम्स व्हिच कुड बी देयर, ऑल ऑफ देम आर एलिमिनेटेड, बिकॉज देन देयर आफ्टर यू आर गोइंग टू यूज द सेम पॉलिसी. नाउ ऑब्जर्व दैट एवरी टाइम माई डिक्लेरेशन इज SLL star H. Even in the create list it was SLL star temp star header star n. So we find that every time I will have to use that word SLL star, and I had defined SLL to avoid the use of struct singly. Instead of writing struct singly at every place, I have type defined it as SLL. But then I should have been doing it like type def struct singly, inside it is same, and I will declare it as star SLLP. Suppose. So I am defining a new type SLLP, which happens to be a pointer type itself. This has got its own advantage that instead of writing it this way, I will say SLLP H. Because the data type itself is pointer, so I don't have to say SLL star, it will be SLLPH. This is going to be SLLPH, and this will be, even get node will return SLLP, create list will return SLLP. Got it? And that will be much better than instead of saying every time SLL star. Because if you forget it once, that will create problems. Now that star, though we are using pointers, that star will never come into picture. But still, the type that we are declaring is a pointer type, because we have type defined it as a pointer. So itni bar star likhne se ek bar yahan likh dete the hum. So we don't have to put that star anywhere. Okay? And then we will stop. We are back.